Take 5 Practical Aspects of the Nutrition Program. After working with many patients over a period of time, it becomes clear that taking an adequate amount of time with people will enhance the effectiveness of the nutrition program. Lifestyle counseling, nutrition counseling, establishing a positive relationship with a patient are all beneficial to the success of nutrition programs, especially this type of nutrition program, which requires a patient's understanding and cooperation. If you don't have sufficient time to spend with your patient, it is wise to employ someone in your office to take the time. On this tape, we'll explore 3 different areas. The first is the explanation of the program in terms of goals, cost, time factor, healing reactions, diet, food, shopping, cooking, substitute products, and mini programs. The second area of consideration is lifestyle counseling, eating habits, exercise, sleep, work, social relationships, and other issues, such as discipline, commitment, awareness, and mental attitude. The third area is the importance of the therapist-patient relationship. We'll begin with explaining the program. Certain points I'll emphasize. The first is that goals and agreeing on certain goals are important. What is it that you, as a doctor or therapist, hope to accomplish? The reason for asking this is that many people come in only concerned about one symptom. And if that symptom isn't removed rapidly, they lose faith and interest in the program. You can avoid that problem and of having people quit after a short time by explaining that the goal of this program is to strengthen the entire body. Symptomatic nutrition, which could help them lose weight rapidly but not permanently, or get rid of their pain rapidly but not permanently, which would leave them in a more unbalanced state, is not really serving their best interest. If a person insists on that type of treatment, symptomatic relief, I tell them to go elsewhere, that I'd prefer not to work that way because I would not feel that I was doing my best for them. So it's important to agree on goals at the very start. It's important to write down all the person's initial complaints. That way, if they later say their arthritis hasn't gone away yet, you can refer back to their initial complaints and you can say, yes, but your digestion's better, your insomnia has improved, your energy is higher, your problem with constipation has lessened, etc. Then they will begin to understand that we're not working with just a single symptom, but with their entire body. Often you can substitute a better goal. For example, instead of getting rid of the headaches, we can say, let's set a goal to eliminate these toxic metals, which are a primary cause of a multiplicity of symptoms. Another issue to discuss is the time required to bring about satisfying results. People in general will be upset if you tell them that within a week or two they will feel better and then it doesn't happen. It's much better to say that 6 months or a year is what it's going to take, at least. For many people, depending on their problems, it will take much more time. That is because we're making deep and lasting correction. So it's good to clarify the time factor. Another important point is the cost of the program. It's important to mention the cost of supplement programs. You may be able to modify the program or place the patient on what is referred to as a mini program if the cost is excessive. But give people an idea of the cost. That's important. Healing reactions and retracing. All of tape 6 deals with healing reactions, so I won't go into it on this tape. However, it's important to alert individuals about reactions. They are to be expected, they will occur if one desires to attain correction rather than just go for symptomatic treatment. Being forewarned, people can usually handle healing reactions that occur. Reactions to vitamins occasionally happen. Always mention that if reactions occur, just call you up and we'll work with it. One note about explaining possible reactions to the program is to remember that there will be emotional reactions as well. It is wise to warn patients about mental depression. A slow oxidizer is particularly prone to depression. If you have a high cadmium level in a slow oxidizer, when that cadmium is eliminated, they will frequently experience depression. If your patient has a high copper level, when the copper is eliminated, they will perhaps experience both depression and anxiety. So it is wise to warn people about this type of reaction. When I first began this work, several people called and said they were in a suicidal depression, and several people actually went to a psychiatrist. If I had warned them beforehand about possible emotional reactions during the program, they may not have felt the need for this other help. If I had alerted them just to call me, I would explain what's going on, we could have taken some action to reduce the eliminative reaction and avoided it. So it is important to know what to expect, especially if toxic metals are present. Another point is it is important to emphasize the need for supplements as well as diet. Many people make the mistake of thinking that if they follow a diet, they can slack off on supplements, or if they take supplements, they don't have to bother with the diet. So it's very important to mention that both diet and nutrient supplementation are important. You may want to look for contraindications for the program. There are very few. I would say the most important contraindication is if the person doesn't want to do it because they're afraid or uncomfortable. Pregnancy is not a contraindication, neither is lactation. Sometimes, however, the baby will be sensitive through the lactating mother, and there may be a need for adjustment of certain supplements. Old age, severe illness, or heavy drug medication are not contraindications, but they may be reasons to go slowly and cautiously. They may require more frequent retesting, and you may need to consult with the laboratory. Another issue is mini programs. You can request a mini program if the patient has a sodium to potassium inversion. In these cases, you may get more effective results if you give only a few supplements that correct the sodium to potassium inversion. Sometimes reducing the supplement program is helpful. The full program is geared to making many changes simultaneously in body chemistry. Just focusing on correcting one ratio and giving only several products to work on that one ratio can make a dramatic difference, and especially can help a person get through a crisis or a difficult period. The full program is making too many changes at once, and during a crisis period or a elimination, the body can't handle it all. This is also true if a person gets a cold or a flu or a sore throat. It's often better to go off the program and perhaps take a few supplements such as limcomin, vitamin A, vitamin C, and that's all, maybe B12 for inversion, until the cold has passed. So the mini program can be a very useful concept, especially for sodium potassium inversion or several other conditions. If all four minerals, calcium, magnesium, sodium, and potassium, are below normal, this is also an indicator at times for a mini program. Sometimes it won't be necessary and the patient will do fine on the regular program. Other times they won't come out of that four low number pattern. And a mini program, which you can call the lab and they will design for you, can be very helpful. Another issue is maintenance programs. Once your patient has reached close to optimum mineral levels or is comfortable with his health status, it would be appropriate to place them on what we refer to as a maintenance program. The maintenance program consists of a rather limited number of supplements which will prevent the individual from regressing back into the previous disease trends and patterns. Maintenance program is normally given to a patient once they are well or satisfied. However, it can be recommended if they have reservations about the program for any reason and don't want to go on a complete program. Our present society with air pollution, water pollution, poor food, and other stress factors makes it a wise idea to continue on some kind of a maintenance program. Another topic is the substitution of products that are recommended on the program. It is not unusual for patients to want to substitute less expensive brands or different products which they have taken in the past, which they felt have been of benefit to them. The basic rule here is that you tell people that you can't guarantee results if they're going to use their own products. This is because many times a person doesn't realize that their own brand is not the same, or they confuse, say, manganese with magnesium, or they don't get the dosages correct. Substitution of products adds many variables to the program. One such variable, for example, is the quality of ingredients or the form the nutrient is in. For example, magnesium comes in many forms. There's magnesium oxide, magnesium chelate, magnesium orotate, gluconate, and ascorbate. There are many forms of each nutrient. When people substitute a cheaper form, the supplement may not be as effective. As far as natural versus synthetic, it depends on what nutrients you're talking about. With vitamin E, it makes a big difference. With vitamin D, C, it is mostly all the same. If you're willing to take the time, you can examine the patient's substitute products to let them know which ones they can substitute and which ones they should not substitute if they want to get results. It is important to point out that less expensive products have problems of quality control of the type of nutrients used, the tableting process, which may make the tablet too hard or insoluble, indigestible, and actually some cheap products don't even contain what they say they contain. The same principle applies to the use of other products such as spirulina, herbs, bee pollen, etc. These products contain many hidden nutrients. Some of these we have analyzed and found to contain toxic metals. For example, bentonite contains dangerous amounts of aluminum. Peppermint tea is also very high in aluminum. Certain herbs are very high in cadmium. In fact, some herbs actually work often by adding toxic metals to the body. It is for this reason alone that an excellent program may be nullified or made much less effective by allowing a patient to select other products, especially herbs. Sometimes other products may help. I'm not saying that they are all bad, but it is wise to be careful, especially with herbs. They often don't mix well because of the high mineral content which these herbs contain and which may oppose those that are recommended. They can unbalance the program. Remember that on this program, sometimes we must make a person feel worse for a while, and if they take an herb that makes them feel better, they may think they're getting better, but they're not. Another topic to discuss with patients is taking supplements, how to do it, when to do it, etc. One should not assume that people know this. It's important that the supplements be taken at spaced intervals, as recommended, and not take the whole day's worth at one time. The supplements should be taken with food. The bottles can be opened 3 times a day, or you can put the daily amount out in the morning, keep them in some convenient place, such as the kitchen or dining room. They can put supplements in little vials or pill cases. One may buy small Ziploc bags and can make up a week's worth or more. You can use an egg crate and set out a week's worth of supplements in the kitchen. Many tricks are possible, and if you help people to take their supplements, they'll get much better results. The next topic is dietary counseling. Don't assume that people understand the principles of a good diet. Many people don't understand how to even read labels. They don't know anything about cooking, or they don't want to know, or they don't have time. There are many things you can recommend. For example, crock pots are excellent. It's really an old-fashioned idea, the old pot on the stove that had something ready at all times. You can put a whole zucchini, a whole onion, a whole chicken into the crock pot In the morning, set it on low for 8 hours. When you come home, you have a good quality hot meal. You don't have to chop up vegetables and do a lot of extra work. Many people are involved in the instant lifestyle, the TV dinner, la menu, lean cuisine. These food products are generally lower in nutritional value. In addition, there are the dangers in accumulating aluminum in body tissues from the aluminum trays that they are cooked in. In the time that it takes to heat up an instant dinner, if a person has a crock pot or if they are willing to make a stir-fry meal, they can produce a meal that is far superior nutritional value. There are also restaurants that are excellent. There are restaurants and fast food places that aren't so good. You may be able to inform a person about ordering fresh food at a restaurant, which restaurants serve better quality, and this kind of thing. The type of cooking utensils can contribute to health or to the lack of it. This is covered to some extent in your patient's report. Stainless steel, enamel, ceramic, or glass should be used. Aluminum cookware is strictly taboo for any number of reasons, including the association between excessive aluminum and Alzheimer's disease. Copper cooking utensils, while of value for those who suffer from low tissue copper levels, should be avoided, especially in those individuals who are taking birth control pills and who have anxiety, depression, and insomnia. Iron cookware is excellent, except for those with a high iron level. Having the proper cooking utensils can make all the difference in the world. Part of this enters into lifestyle and taking the time to take care of your body. But it is a mistake to think that a person has to spend hours in the kitchen in order to eat well. I certainly never give that impression to my patients. The majority of individuals do not care to spend that kind of time, but they do want something quick and yet nutritious. Where to shop for food may also be very important. You may help people by giving them prepared sheets, telling them where they can get good quality food inexpensively. Health food stores, outlet stores, vegetable markets, and this kind of thing. Many of the vegetables today are of such poor quality that it's no wonder people don't want to eat them. So if you can tell a person about a farmer's market or an oriental market or some other place, you may help them tremendously to stay on the program and eat the right food. Of course, you can also recommend cookbooks, cooking courses, and other books that may be helpful. Another area of great importance is the need to explain the procedure of the new nutrition programs and retesting. This is very important. What I mean is that it is often necessary to explain about mid-course corrections, a little like navigating a ship, and every now and then a correction in course must be done. A hair analysis retest provides us with a great deal of important information. You need to explain the need for retests, why the program has to be redesigned, why it's irresponsible to go more than 6 months, preferably 3 months, without a retest. The main reason is the chemistry will change and the program will no longer be applicable. The person could start getting worse again by staying on the old program when it is no longer appropriate. So it's important to explain the retest procedure and why we do it the way we do. Make sure that your patient, when you go over the test, understands how to read the hair analysis chart, what the little asterisks mean, pointing out the normal values, taking a few minutes to go over the paragraphs. You may assume people understand when they don't. Another topic to do with practical aspects of the program are checkup visits. Checkup visits are very important. There may be other issues, for example, concerning the program that are individual which you don't have time to discuss on a primary visit. Weight loss, weight gain, other things. Prevention of disease, lifestyle, and so forth. It's important that retests or checkups be done, preferably every month to 6 weeks. and then you can talk about some of these issues. Menstrual periods will fluctuate. People will usually have questions. Also, you'll need to sustain enthusiasm in the program. In the beginning, people may need your sincere enthusiasm in order to get going. Later, as they go through the plateaus, which they will do, explain that the healing process is not a linear one, but rather one of ups and downs, like two steps forward and one step back, two steps forward, one step back. This is often the way the healing process works. It is often necessary for the body to accumulate mineral reserves. The body must accumulate adaptive energy to go forward with the healing process. Then it goes forward and then it rests and replenishes. The person's energy may get very low, then it will come up again. It is imperative to explain all this. The checkup visits may also be a time where you modify the program if necessary. I suggest to patients they write down their questions and save them to ask at a checkup visit, unless they're urgent, in which case they should call. People often bring a list of questions, and that's just great. If you do modify the program, do it very cautiously. I let patients know that I'll modify their program if it's necessary, sometimes more supplements, sometimes fewer, and so forth. But often the program is okay, and just because someone has had a reaction, it is temporary and does not warrant a change in the program. Some people have great self-discipline, are enthusiastic, will call if they have questions. You don't have to see these people on such a regular basis. Others need to have their hand held a little more and need regular contact. About 8 months after starting a program, often there is lagging enthusiasm. People's friends are often working on them, telling them that they're wasting their time, their vitamins are bad for them, and a million other excuses. They may need your contrast, your support, to strengthen them. Don't assume that anyone else is supporting a patient on his nutrition program. You are probably the only one. They may be fighting their whole family, all their friends, their other doctor if they have one, and so forth. Now we'll move on to lifestyle counseling. Health is not simply what you eat. Just as on an earlier tape we discussed that the critical factor about the new nutrition is that it is a systems approach, that we're not looking at isolated parts, meaning that not one vitamin and one mineral, but rather the whole mineral system and the totality of interactions between minerals. On a different level, life too is a conglomeration of parts, of which diet and food supplements is but one part. There are other factors, and if we can look at the person's life as a totality, we'll achieve better results, much better results. So what does this totality consist of? First of all, eating habits are important. These include the way you eat, not only what you eat. Eating on the run, taking 10 minutes to eat, screaming at children while eating, and many other habits are very common. Because of the opposition of sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system activity, this kind of distraction and stress during meals promotes poor digestion and assimilation. It is wise to sit down, eat slowly, and eat regularly. For many people, freedom means not having to be on a schedule. In fact, it's the exact opposite. Regularity and structure in a person's life makes for freedom. That may seem like a contradiction, but I always ask people who are up in years, who are very healthy, what their secret is. It is the discipline of regular habits. They get up at the same time, they go to work at the same time. This structure is what they build their freedom around and their health. There is an analogy in our bodies. If we didn't have bones, which are rigid, we couldn't be flexible. We couldn't even move effectively. It is the fact that we have rigid structures, the bones, that allow the muscles to attach and that allow the muscles to move. So you might say it's a contradiction that by having rigidness in your body, you allow movement. but that's the truth. And the same holds true for lifestyle. By having some rigidness, some regularity, which you make yourself, I'm not talking about an imposed schedule from without, you allow freedom and support health. Regular meals, quiet meals, relaxed meals are very important. Often not drinking too much liquid with the meal, which can dilute digestive juices, is also helpful. The water one drinks is important. The best water is either distilled or derived from the use of a reverse osmosis unit with a carbon filter. A carbon block filter, which is compressed carbon, is the next best. One way you can determine your patient's lifestyle habits is a simple questionnaire, often just by asking what they eat for breakfast, snack, lunch, snack, dinner, and then snack in the evening, or by keeping a diary of everything they eat for a couple of days. This alone will provide you with a great deal of information about a person's eating habits. Another question that I ask is, what kind of exercise do you do and how much? Contrary to popular belief, many people today are exercising excessively. The reason is their bodies are exhausted, yet they are engaged in aerobics, jazzercise, and jogging several miles a day, together with yet other forms of vigorous exercise in order to feel better. Why do they feel better? Because exercise enables one to temporarily pick up adrenal activity. Exercise is a powerful adrenal stimulant. If you're a slow oxidizer, or if you have a sodium-potassium inversion, when you speed up the adrenal glands, you'll feel better. The chemistry of your body will be temporarily better balanced. Sodium and potassium levels will rise, enhancing energy levels and raising blood sugar levels, while the concomitant elimination of calcium and magnesium will result in an enhancement of thyroid function. As a slow oxidizer, this is such a common phenomena that it's almost unbelievable. Temporary enhancement of energy levels results in improvement of mental depression, constipation, a return of appetite. In other words, many of the positive aspects of a balanced chemistry can be achieved with exercise. The only trouble is that these changes are temporary. Excessive exercise over an extended period of time will eventually result in diminished adrenal activity or adrenal burnout. Many individuals start on a nutrition program and begin to feel better. Then they decide to get into a heavy exercise program, and they finally end up dissipating all the energy that they gained by the program. And the end result is they're back where they started from. Their body couldn't handle the extra stress resulting from the exercise. Many people need to reduce their exercise activity temporarily in order to get well. Yes, they will feel depressed. Their copper will rise because good adrenal function is required to stimulate ceruloplasm production. Ceruloplasm is a copper-binding protein, and a deficiency of ceruloplasm results in accumulation of copper in various storage areas, resulting in various metabolic dysfunction. When adrenal function is impaired, ceruloplasm production is low, copper builds up. Excessive copper can cause depression, constipation, and many other symptoms. The answer is usually a modification of the exercise, a slowdown. Individuals must recognize they are using exercise to boost themselves up.
By taking scientifically designed nutrient formulas, by eating better, by getting lots of rest, and by engaging in moderate exercise only, they will get better results.
An analogy I use on this question of activity is that if you have a broken arm, you don't keep using it. Many people have, quote, broken glands. People 20 years of age have broken down glands. They find it difficult to get out of bed in the morning. They're depressed. They're fatigued. The answer is not to use the broken down, depleted glands. Rest them. It's okay to feel tiredness. One doesn't have to get depressed about it. One can realize that we're in the process of getting well. You will get well. If you don't get upset about it, if you don't try to copy your friends and try to do as much activity and exercise as they do. They may actually be just as tired and just don't show it. If a person's healthy, he can handle vigorous exercise, but a great majority today are very burned out and vigorous programs are not helping them. Exercise is only a temporary stimulatory measure for these people, like coffee, sugar, cigarettes, marijuana, and loud music, to name a few other distractions. You want to get away from that and really rebuild the chemistry. If you see adrenal exhaustion on a patient's hair chart, or if a person says they feel exhausted, have them reduce activity levels. Moderate exercise, walking, swimming, bicycle, riding, are advisable, if they are done so as not to whip the adrenals into forced action. Explain to people that this limitation on strenuous activity need not be forever. It is until they rebuild their energy-producing glands, like putting your arm in a cast until the arm heals. Then they may resume their former exercise routine. Another important topic is sleep. Many people don't sleep enough. In some cases, they can't sleep. If sleeping is not possible, taking naps is just about as good. An analogy here I use is that we're providing the building materials for rebuilding your house. I tell patients who have an accumulation of toxic metals that it is as though their house is not built out of the correct materials. There weren't enough proper building materials to go around, so other inferior materials is substituted. We are now providing the correct ones. But just like a builder who assembles all his materials, if he's running around all the time, the materials will not get incorporated and the house won't get built. So it is with people who don't sleep, don't rest, don't stop, who just keep going, living like a chicken with its head off lifestyle. A great deal of healing takes place while you sleep. This needs to be emphasized. 8 hours or more is required for an individual in a state of burnout. The only alternative is to nap, and sometimes a 15 to 30 minute nap in the afternoon can be worth an hour or 2 hours of sleep at night. So sleep is extremely important. By the way, as long as we're discussing the house analogy, I also use it to explain why it takes so much time on the program. I tell people that if we were to remove all the inferior building materials, the toxic metals, all at once, the whole house would collapse. What the body does in its wisdom, therefore, is to replace one at a time, one brick at a time. That way it doesn't collapse. But that process can take a year, 2 years, 3 years. Occupation is another activity and issue. It is easy to ask on a questionnaire, what is your occupation? People may elaborate or you may ask a question about it. Some people are involved in a work situation that is impairing their health. It can be the pressure on the job, or it can be the boss, or a high-pressure job, or the type of work they do. It can be a wonderful kind of work, but the wrong kind of work for that person. Sometimes you can discern that in a person's attitude about his or her occupation. One woman that came to me was working in a jet engine factory polishing metal parts and not wearing a mask and was getting metal poisoning. What a person does for 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, can seriously affect their health. Many jobs are meaningless today. People inside of themselves may sense this. They may say it's a great job, it may pay well, there may be great benefits, but inside they realize they're wasting their life. You may be able to help a person articulate that to himself. Once a person feels stronger, they'll feel like taking a risk, quitting the job, going elsewhere, becoming their own boss maybe, or doing something they would prefer. So a work situation can enhance the nutrition program, or it can be a block. Interpersonal relationships can also enhance or seriously impair one's recovery. Some people are being driven crazy by boyfriends, girlfriends, or spouse. Others are being manipulated. They may not be aware of it. And sometimes this will come up in conversation. And if you're the type that likes to listen to this and can help people, you may be able to assist a person to see what's going on. Other relationships are beautiful and support the program, probably in a way that nothing else can. We frequently see that when a person falls in love, the minerals often balance beautifully. There's a reduction of stress. It seems, however, that for many people, to be alone is better than to be involved in a bad relationship. To advise a person to take it easy, go it alone, relax for a while, is fine. Because when they have more energy, they will be better able to enter into a meaningful relationship. Many people don't have the energy needed for a relationship. Often, it's possible to predict a potential divorce from a hair analysis, because these are the people with severe sodium-potassium inversions. They're burned out, indecisive, frustrated, and resentful. They can't handle social relationships with another person. Silly for them to try. They will just waste the energy they do have. Often, I recommend to people, first get healthy. Work on balancing your chemistry, become strong inside, and then you can be able to handle another person much more easily. Such advice on lifestyle may seem completely contradictory to the psychiatrist who says go out there and fight your depression and meet people. But our experience is that if one's chemistry is imbalanced and weak, such efforts will more likely than not prove futile and discouraging. We've observed this in many, many people. Once the chemistry is strong, balanced, the person is grounded, their mind and senses and everything is working better, relationships come naturally because a person has the necessary energy to share, energy to love. Many people want to love, want to give, but if they don't have the energy, it's like trying to feed someone when you don't have the food yourself. So personal relationships are an important and sometimes sticky area, but they are an important part of lifestyle. A good partner, one who truly cares on a deep level, can help someone work with bad habits, stop wasting energy, and help them straighten out very well. Those relationships which are what I call mutual ego trips, you scratch my back, I'll scratch yours, this does not tend to improve a person's health or lifestyle or character. If you can discern what's going on, you may be able to help someone else recognize it. Another area is that of mental attitudes. Once again, you may want to get involved in this or not, but mental attitudes do affect the program and health very much. We said on an earlier tape that one's emotional attitudes can cause both favorable or unfavorable changes in chemistry. Certain emotions can actually cause copper accumulations, such as fear. Cadmium accumulations can be caused by emotions. Iron is associated with hostility. So many times, people are structured in their mental attitudes and emotional patterns, and they need to break them. Nutrition alone, powerful as it is not the whole answer. A very important attitude that is helpful is to realize that we, meaning I, am not all that there is in the universe. In other words, to go to another level and let's say that I'm a part of a larger scheme. Each one of us is an integral part of that larger scheme. If we're to fully understand life, we have to see that. We have to see that there is a life greater than ourselves. There's a whole system greater than ourselves. It's governed by natural laws, spiritual laws, physical laws, social laws, moral laws, such as the Golden Rule. If a person is caught up in himself and fails to see the whole, they will suffer, and they will not have the health they could have attained. This is called selfishness, and the other state is referred to as awareness. It is sometimes called a state of grace, in which you know that you're in harmony with a larger system. All too many people are caught up in selfishness. On a nutritional level, many people are caught up in one vitamin, one mineral, one disease, one symptom. That's a partial approach. You'll never achieve really good results that way. In terms of lifestyle, some people are caught up in one part of their lifestyle, exercise, diet, vitamins, some spiritual practice. That's only one part. If they don't view the total picture, they'll never have the best health. And on another level, many people are caught up with themselves as individuals, the me generation. They excuse it. They say, well, you have to take care of yourself, you have to have a million excuses for this and that, instead of seeing that they are part of a larger system of humanity, of the human race, of the population of the earth. These things transcend us as individuals. Any kind of awareness technique that will help a person to see himself can be helpful. Slow techniques, quiet techniques, such as Tai Chi, yoga, and meditation, which is an awareness kind of meditation, not relaxation exercises. These don't really go deep enough, although they can help a little. People who are caught up in themselves are also very unhappy people. They're frustrated when they don't get what they want, and they're frustrated when they do get it. There's frequently no end to their desires. We've all probably experienced this unhappy state. There's a book called The Art of Selfishness by David Seabury that touches on this subject, if you're interested. I've mentioned the importance of discipline, the importance of structure, the sort of cybernetic concept that you have to have structure in order to have function. In order to function healthfully, you need to put structure into your life. Structure is in whatever you like or whatever you're comfortable with. If you want to stay up all night, sleep all day, fine, that's a structure. But structure, just like bone structure, gives us freedom. And true discipline comes out of seeing the need for it for yourself, not because someone just told you about it. Another important issue is commitment. Commitment to getting well is a quality that you can mention to a patient. No one achieves anything worthwhile without commitment, certainly not on a nutrition program. The attainment of health requires a time commitment, a cost commitment, a certain amount of self-discipline commitment. Whatever gimmicks are needed to sustain and assist this commitment are worth cultivating. Finally, another principle of lifestyle is the principle of awareness. As a nutritional consultant, you can help a person to be nutritionally aware of what they need. That is what we're really doing on a deep level with these programs. You can also help a person to be aware of eating habits, sleeping habits, exercise habits, attitudes, and this kind of thing. Awareness brings health because the body is a self-correcting mechanism. What keeps us going day to day and moment to moment is the self-correcting ability of our bodies. When you suffer a cut, it is aware of it and it heals it. Everything will heal if the awareness mechanisms, the feedback mechanisms, are working properly. If you can see that you need to sleep and you sleep, if you see when you need to exercise or when to be with people, when to be apart, when to eat, when not to eat, you will be healthy. So awareness is a central concept. Awareness of one's true needs is central. Lifestyle counseling, nutritional counseling, explaining the hair chart are really powerful tools to help a person become more self-aware. Now we'll turn to the relationship between a practitioner and the patient. There's a new style emerging of therapist-patient relationships, which is more like a consultant. Now, some of this is a personal matter, and patients will seek out doctors or therapists who they like and feel comfortable with. That's fine, and the intent here is not to impose one way or another of interacting with a client or patient. But what is very clear is that in order for one to succeed with these nutrition programs, it's going to require more effort on the part of the patient than is required in your traditional medical approach. In the traditional approach, the patient is generally passive. He's given a prescription, relies on a table while someone does something to him. He's in a passive role. For nutrition to be effective, a more active role is required. The relationship between therapist and patient needs to be modified. To take a more active role, the patient needs to be informed. He needs to know how to take intelligent action. He needs to know to stop supplements if he has a reaction. He needs to know when to call you. He needs to develop common sense in choosing food. He needs to know what to order when eating in restaurants. He also needs to know how to act with people and how to deal with criticism, ridicule, and questions that come up when a person mentions they're on a nutrition program or when they pull out their little bottle of vitamins. This kind of thing doesn't happen when you are simply given penicillin or some medicine. You're not touching any of those other areas. But with the mineral balancing science, we are. So the kind of relationship between the doctor or therapist and his patient is important. Many people think that once you just are given the program and that's all there is to it, and the person is on their own, that they don't need a doctor anymore. This is not true. The program is highly technical. If you've studied these tapes and studied this work, you know that a person who understands his material possesses highly technical knowledge that at any particular moment may be needed by a patient. A patient can go into a reaction, a healing crisis, as we call it, a toxic elimination. The chemistry may change. A disturbing symptom may appear. People do need some guidance. It's not a self-help system. I wish it were. It would be nice, but it isn't. It is not wise to just say, here's the program, goodbye. On the other hand, the old paternal relationship of just let me worry about everything, you just take your pills, generally won't work either. Something in between is necessary. Something in which you take time, where you explain. Almost like a friend, but it's a consultant role. This is what we are doing. I'm doing my part. You do your part. You consult me on the technical details, because it's a technical journey. It's a journey to a high level of health in which the practitioner is the guide until such time as the patient's body can take over. That's a very important concept. We're not creating dependence. That's not the goal. At least it's certainly not the goal that I would want to work with. We are, quote, flying the person's body by manual pilot until such time as his or her body can get back on its own autopilot. In other words, in illness, the body's defenses have drifted off course so that the usual navigation and guidance systems simply aren't working anymore. The body is so exhausted and under so many bad influences, whether they be friends, nutritional stress, mental attitudes, that it can no longer fly straight. It can no longer be self-correcting. Therefore, the person gets sicker, more exhausted, and more burned out. What we are doing as doctors and therapists, by getting the assessment of the body chemistry, by analyzing the total situation, by giving the appropriate foods, nutrients, and lifestyle suggestions, we are flying that body by manual control while giving the person the awareness and understanding of what we're doing until such time as the normal regulatory mechanisms can begin to operate again. And they will. They'll begin to work again, and it is a relief when the body begins to function normally again. Those of you who have ever been sick or chronically ill know all about this. When you're sick, you can feel like every moment is a struggle, that your body isn't doing anything. You have to worry about this, worry about sleep, worry about exercise, worry about everything. Then, as you regain health, the body begins to know. It begins to tell you a little more, and things go smoother. Another phenomenon that should not be ignored is that of transference. Transference is the idea that everyone who's ill really has two diseases. One is the disease itself. The other is the anxiety about the disease. Now, often there's a third factor also, which is resentment about being sick. If you, as the therapist, understand this, you can take over some of the anxiety and thereby reduce the number of diseases by one. That often will give the body a chance to heal itself. In other words, the body can only handle so much. It is doing its best. If it can be relieved of some of the burden, it will do better. This is often the reason why people get well with placebos and just by talking to someone, is because the problem may not go away, but the anxiety about it is relieved. Many people also, as I mentioned earlier, have a certain anger or resentment about being sick, not being able to do what they want. And very frequently, this can also be worked with and explained, that's normal, but don't be that way, because that just gets in the way. The mineral balancing program can then be freer to work on the original problem from a biochemical standpoint. The person hopefully can see that getting upset about being sick doesn't help any. So the idea of transference is that you can transfer anxiety from the patient to the practitioner. Of course, as a practitioner, in order to do this properly, you don't want to get involved emotionally with a patient. There is a quality called compassion in which you say, I see where you are, I see where you're coming from, I see what's going on, and I'll do what I can. But it is not wise to identify or feel sorry or pity the person, because those attitudes will make you sick. You'll be taking on more than their anxiety. You'll actually take on their symptoms. And there can be a transference of symptoms. It is important to remain detached, but compassionate. Two other roles that therapists can play that are important are, one, you may know about other supportive therapies that would be helpful for your patient. There's nothing wrong with recommending these. It's better not to recommend other supportive therapy at the outset, because people may question your faith in your own nutritional approach. But a couple of months into the program, or even weeks into the program, if you see that structural work or something else that is balancing and non-toxic, preferably, would be helpful, that's fine. And be careful about whom you recommend, because you must have a relationship yourself with other physician or therapist. You must trust them that they will not give bad or opposing dietary advice, that they won't step out of the bounds of their professional area and interfere with you. Another role for the nutritional consultant is the relationship with a medical doctor. If you are a medical doctor, you can ignore this section. But if you're not, you must realize that many people are on medications. Many people are considering surgeries. It's important to talk about this and to let a person understand without imposing your views. In other words, I am very clear, for example, that for legal reasons, if nothing else, that a nutritional consultant does not prescribe medications or take people off prescribed medications. That is a private matter between a patient and his medical doctor. However, we can describe the way a medicine is affecting the chemistry and the body. Many times it is wise to remain on medicines because the effect of the nutrition program will be slow. Medicines do harm the nutritional status in many, many subtle ways. They frequently affect the liver, affect the kidneys, disrupt intestinal flora, and so forth. Surgery is a great stress on the body. It doesn't matter that you're asleep during it. It's still a great stress. This can be pointed out, but sometimes surgery is also a wise choice. It's helpful to say that you're willing to talk with a medical doctor, to work together, and to explain what you're doing. But remember that surgery and medicine are helpful and necessary at times. The nutrition program can take several years. An extremely high blood pressure has to be dealt with somehow. There may be need for medication in certain cases. Your patient may be afraid of what his medical doctor might think if you told him about a nutrition program. If you sense that a person isn't talking to their doctor, you can point out that a person should not be afraid to speak up to his doctor. If a person's afraid of his doctor, there's something wrong with that relationship. A final area for the therapist or consultant or physician to emphasize is that the positive points about the program must be reiterated. This is important because people do get discouraged and lose enthusiasm. Often their friends and their families may think it's wacky and a waste of time and money. So there are certain things you can remind people of. Number one, we're doing prevention. We're not just correcting present symptoms. We're looking years ahead. We're also undoing much of the past, maybe two generations from the past. Number two, we're making deep correction. We're not just getting rid of symptoms, but we're actually correcting chemistry at the very deepest enzymatic levels. This is a much more profound work than symptomatic nutrition. Number three, I remind people that the cost of the program should be compared to the cost of the hospital. We are often keeping people out of hospitals. If not now, later. Number four, we are working with emotional health as well as physical health. We're actually improving the ability to function and the inner strength of this person. Number five, we are helping a person to handle stress in many ways. If you're stronger, you're less sensitive to stress, and if you reduce internal stress, you are more able to handle more stress from the outside. Reducing stress results in health improvement in many ways. These are some of the major points that you often will need to remind people of. Remind people that they've made progress, that they have made, and where they came from. These are the kind of things that will keep a patient on the program. It's not that we're out to sell vitamins, but we know that time is needed and that it's easy to forget where we were originally, and we need that kind of encouragement. This concludes the tape.